Hope you're enjoying everything that the Touchline is offering you here on Y254. Just away from that, that was Musa Otieno with his foundation kickoff to Hope Kenya on his way of giving back to society after playing for Kenya for a very long time. Now we shift gears to athletics because it has been a very big week for athletics in the country and also internationally, because there was a ruling that was made and now Caster Semenya will not be racing in the 400 meters to the mile. What is the impact of that ruling? Joining us here today to talk about that ruling is one of Kenya's most celebrated athletics and sports journalists, Mr. Mutwiri Mutwota, who is the CNN 2008 Africa winner and also the digital content editor at SportPesa. Mutwiri, karibu sana to Y254, The Touchline. First of all,
thank you.
What was your reaction when that ruling came out?
Well, I was expecting such a ruling because there is so much into this affair that meets the eye. First things first, the whole Caster Semenya affair,
yes,
which started in 2009, just before the Berlin World Championships,
yes,
where she ran as a senior for the first time. It is one issue that IAAF have been trying to sweep under the carpet. If you go to the genesis of this thing, is that at the 2009 Africa Junior Championships,
yes,
that is where she was first seen. And then she ran some crazy time, I think it was 155.
Uh-huh.
When she ran there, yeah, the late Athletics Kenya president, Isaiah Kiplagat, is, yeah, actually the first person who actually raised the issue about Caster,
yes,
saying that yes, she won the junior race and beating the Kenyans at the time, but she needs to be looked at. So the IAAF commissioned a gender test,
yes,
on her. Yeah. And the results were leaked out to an Australian newspaper when somebody disposed them in a trash can. At that time, she had already been entered for the World Championships.
Yes.
So when she won the gold medal, something very peculiar happened. She was not at the press conference for the gold medalist, and she did not even finish her lap of honor. As the world sought to know who is she and why has she been brought into the sport.
Yes.
Now, since then, it has been one tug of war back and forth between the IAAF, between Caster, and the South Africa itself, because the nation of South Africa,
yes,
fell behind the athlete.
Yes.
At some point, she was ordered to take the kind of hormonal treatment now she has been ordered to do now in order to run 800 meters.
Yeah.
But the ruling was challenged. Okay. So IAAF under Sebastian Coe came up with these new rules,
yeah,
where they tried to define exactly what are the threshold of for somebody competing as a female athlete.
Okay.
And those gender hormonal thresholds,
yes,
to reduce them, you have now to take drugs so that you can feel within that threshold in an attempt to level the field.
Yeah.
And when the CAS ruling came out earlier this week, they said, yes, these rules are discriminatory, but they are needed to level the playing field.
Yes.
So if you ask me, this whole Caster Semenya affair, it has been one way of the IAAF, they have been trying to get rid of this problem for over a decade.
Yes.
Because fundamentally, she did nothing wrong. She's not the one who entered herself in any race. She was entered, first of all, by her nation in 2009 at the Africa Youth Championships.
Mm-hmm.
They went on to enter her again into the World Championships. And since then, she has been competing, entered by her federation.
Yes.
So in all this affair, it's a very sad affair, because what IAAF is trying to do now is to show us that you can apply the rules based on what is fitting at that particular point in time. For example, you are saying that we cannot dope our athletes.
Yes.
We know we have a big problem with doping in this country.
Yeah.
But then again, you are saying some athletes are allowed to take medicine, mm-hmm, or to take drugs, mm-hmm, so that they can reduce or they can reduce their hormones.
Yeah.
So it's a very gray area, but IAAF has not covered itself in glory.
Because now the question comes is, what kind of precedent that IAAF has set? Because now you are saying that you can take drugs to reduce your hormonal advantage. You can also not take drugs because you are a clean athlete. So what kind of precedent has this set for the future in athletics?
The future of athletics now has gone into a gray area, because there's an Indian athlete also who challenged, uh-huh, those rules.
Yes.
And Caster ruled in her favor.
Mm-hmm.
But she's a sprinter.
Yeah.
It means that Caster can run between 200 and 400 meters, skip 800 meters and 15,
mm-hmm,
and compete from 5,000 going above.
Yes.
So what are we trying to do here? Are we targeting her specifically because she's so good in these two distances? She won, mm-hmm, the Commonwealth gold medals last year,
yes,
at both distances, 800 and 15.
Yes.
Very likely she was going to double in Doha in September, and she would at the on the strength of everything should still dominate the two distances.
Yeah.
So what are we trying to say here? That these rules are being applied selectively, if you ask me.
Yeah.
Because if you look at it, she has fundamentally done nothing wrong. All she does, she wants to do is to compete.
Yeah.
But there has been other people who feel like she has an advantage that should be addressed.
Yeah.
But this thing should have been addressed from 2009.
Yes.
When the problem came in, when it was first noticed that in Mauritius, during the Africa Juniors, they would have said, okay, guys, please don't enter this athlete. Let us figure out how to deal with these cases, and then we can come back.
Yeah.
But she ran in Berlin and won, beating Janet Jepkoskei and Jenny Meadows. Our own Janet Jepkoskei was the world champion then, and Jenny Meadows from Britain. I was at that press conference after that race.
The 2009 Berlin World Championship.
And the press conference was crazy. Journalists all over the world were asking, they were doubting her agenda, first of all.
Yes.
And secondly, whether it was unfair. And at that time, the person who sat in the seat where Semenya would have been sitting was the former IAAF Vice Secretary General, Pierre Weiss.
Yes.
And he could not answer this question. So it is one problem, but I don't think they have cleared the problem. What they have opened up is they have opened up the leeway for other people to challenge whatever the set of rules that you are putting up.
Yeah, because now, the one thing that now the rules apply to 400 meters hurdles, 800 meters, and 1,500 meters to the 1 mile.
Yes.
Now, what will be the difference when she goes to the 5,000 meters? Because now you realize that if she's running the shorter races, it's more about her muscle and the strength. But for the 5,000 meters, 10,000 meters, endurance comes into play. So what kind of technicalities will be looking at when she goes on for these higher races?
The technicalities here are very simple. When she won Doha yesterday, 800 meters, she did a 155.
Yes.
Which is a very good time considering we are still in May.
Mm-hmm.
If you put it into perspective, it means she said yesterday, she was asked, are you going to take the hormonal drugs? And her answer was very emphatic, hell no.
Yeah.
So it means that for her to defend her title in Doha, she has to start medication Wednesday next week.
Uh-huh.
And if she doesn't take that medication, it means she's free to run between 100 meters and 400 meters, as you stated.
Yes.
And she's free also to compete in anything from 5,000 to the marathon.
Yes.
So What we have opened here is a technicality where what is going to happen. If she competes after taking medication that she was forced to do like for 2 years, between when she won the Olympics in London and between she reclaimed the world title, Semenya was not featuring anywhere in the top brackets of her sport.
Mm-hmm.
But now she came back very strongly to win the world title, to win another Olympics title, to win two Commonwealth titles. So what the future holds is, right now, we cannot say we know.
Yes.
We just have to wait to see what reaction she has said she's not going to take the medicine.
Uh-huh.
So, is she going to compete in any other Diamond League meeting in 800 meters or 1500 meters?
Yes.
Or does that mean it's the end of her career? Because that is one option.
Yes.
She tweeted sometime last night about something cryptical about her considering quitting the sport.
Yes.
That is one option.
Uh-huh.
She can actually quit the sport and decide to put an end to this matter.
Yeah.
Or let's see whether she's going to step up the distance, whether she can train to compete with the Obiris of this hole in the 5,000 meters.
Uh-huh. Now, the thing is, the options that they are giving her to go and take into the marathon in other disciplines that they are giving her between 400 and the mile, but also they are giving her an option to run with the male candidates. How will that come out to be like? Because can they prove also that the male testosterone at the level with which Caster Semenya's are?
They can't prove it. And if you put your question into perspective, or in look at it in another way, would she be allowed to take drugs to maybe raise her hormonal levels to compete with the best males?
Yes, of this world. Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying. It opens a very, very gray area in the sport, because now we have seen athletes who are permitted to take drugs to cure a certain condition that they were born with.
Mm-hmm.
But we are prohibiting drugs to enhance performance.
Yes.
So if Semenya today decides to enter the 800 meters and compete with Akina Rudisha and Akina Ferguson, or teachers of this world, and the Emmanuel Corrils, will she now apply to take some drugs to enhance? Because her levels are considered not eligible to compete as a female in certain distances.
Yes.
Not compete as a female per se, but in certain distances.
Yes.
So the same threshold does not fit if she decides today, let me take on Akina David Rudisha.
In the 800 meters?
Yes.
Wow.
So it is quite a decision that, to be honest, to me, it doesn't make any sense. Huh. It is fundamentally wrong.
Yes.
Although it has been taken by the highest court in the sports. Mm-hmm. And it is not practicable because it seems it's targeting one athlete.
And that is Semenya.
And that is Caster Semenya.
Yeah. Can she win the appeal? What might happen in that appeal?
Well, I think the Court of Appreciation for Sport is the very last
the option.
Option for her.
Yes.
Because when the IAAF ruled this through the IAAF appeals board,
yes,
they referred the matter to the CAS. So after the CAS, now it means we have drawn a line under that matter, but the questions still remain.
Yeah.
So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens in the next few weeks and months. If she decides to quit the sport, or whether she will decide to step up, because, but one thing we know, according to what she said last night, is that she's not going to take any treatment, meaning she can't be eligible to defend her title in Doha.
Yeah. Now, let's move away from Caster Semenya a little bit and talk about IAAF and their sports and actually targeting African athletes. I might be wrong, but I think there was a time when it came out that the Diamond League also and IAAF wanted to scrap off the 5,000 meters and the 10,000 meters because these are events that are majorly dominated by Africans and more so Kenyans, Ethiopians. Is this something that is now coming out into open that these are clandestine meetings which they are having to target African athletes?
Well, former Olympic champion and world record meter, 800 meter record holder Sebastian Coe, when he took over IAAF in 2016, he had four pillars of reform.
Yes.
One of them was the anti-doping and dealing with issues like Semenya.
Yes.
The other one was to make the sport appeal more to a younger audience.
Yes.
Because they were struggling to sell events. They're also struggling to attract the so-called the young audience right now.
Yes.
That we have, the one that is so savvy on technology and social media and stuff.
Yeah.
The other pillar was integrity in the sport and financial management.
Yes.
And the fourth was trying to remodel the sport to make it more exciting to a wider audience.
Yes.
So one of the things we have to know is that since then, the measures coming from Monaco seems slanted against what Africans are good at. So what are we good at? Distance races on the track, right?
Yeah.
Or let's say middle to long distance, where there is no more competition from the Europeans, from the Americans, and from the Asians.
Yes.
To understand this more, the sport of athletics, there are three regions in the world that drive it commercially.
Yeah.
One is the Americans, the second is the Europe,
yes,
and then we have the Asia, and a bit of Oceania.
Yes.
So as Africans, we provide talent to the athletics table, but we don't provide the resources.
Yes.
So that is why you see all these steps that are coming from Monaco, they seem slanted against events that Africans participate in. After some outcry, except even from the people who have done so well in the sport.
Yes.
People like Haile, people like Eliud, people like, you name them, from Africa.
Yes.
Hisham El Gerouj and all that. They said wiping out distance races from the track is detrimental in two ways. One, you're killing the whole idea of progression in athletics.
Yes.
Most people, they should progress through the distances from 800, 1500, 5000, 10000 to the marathon.
Yes.
And that is why Eliud is doing so well, if you want to know why.
Yes.
It's because he started his career at 1500, he went to the 5000, he did a few 10,000 races, to the half marathon, and so on and so forth, to where he is right now.
Yes.
You notice those athletes who go from straight to the roads when they are very young.
They do not make
They do not stay it for so many years. You see somebody is around for 2-3 good years, then that's it.
Yes.
So there is that natural progression, you're killing it. Secondly, you're trying to punish athletes for excellence. Because Kenyans and Ethiopians win all the time, almost all the time in the 5,000 and 10,000 meter races.
Yes.
You're punishing them for being good at doing something.
Yes.
Yet we never punish the Jamaicans and the Americans for being good in the sprints.
In the sprints, yeah.
except when there was Mofara, when Mofara was running, winning everything.
Yeah.
We never had these things of finishing the 5,000 and 10,000 in the Diamond League.
Yes.
In fact, they were even having events to add the 5,000 and 10,000 so for more to come and run in. And we are now hearing him also saying that he's not going to, he refused a chance to run for Britain in the marathon.
Yeah.
He wants to come back to the 10,000 meters. So after some protest, IAAF clarified. And I'm saying clarified with quotes because they did not say that we are bound to pressure. They said we have clarified and said that we are going to have these races continuing, but we are not going to see them on TV.
Yes.
Which again raises another question. If I'm running, because I have a shoe contract, I have a kit contract, I have a watch contract and all that, and I'm not being seen on TV, then why am I going to run if the only thing I'm going to run for is the prize money? Which if you ask people who do this sport, they tell you the prize money is not that much.
It's not
It's the endorsements, that they make money from.
Yes.
So we can say that loosely, IAAF, they are putting policies and measures that seem to be choking the African sport.
Wow. It's a tough one. Let's move away from most of the negative parts and come back home here where we are dominating at all. Yesterday you were watching the Diamond League that is happening in Doha, and one event that we dominated was the 1,500 meters men. How good were we in that race? All the seven of Kenyans went on to win it.
It is just a very good thing that if you look at the 1,500 meters world title,
yes,
it has been held by a Kenyan since 2011. It has not left this this country since 2011.
Yes.
Asbel did it 2011, 13 and 15. Manangwe took over in 15.
Yes.
One thing about Kenyan athletics over the years, what I've noticed is that there's always something we call the copycat effect, where if we are doing very well in a discipline, you'll find so many good runners in that discipline.
Yes.
Because the beauty about our athletics is whenever somebody wins, they inspire a whole generation.
Yes.
They inspire a whole, for example, 800 meters was dead since Billy Conchola.
Yes.
Since the days of Billy Conchola. Until Rudisha came.
Yes.
Now from Rudisha, we've seen a few good 800 meters come. Timothy Kitumi, Manuel Koril, Saruni, Rotich, Ferguson. Yes. So there is hope in 800 meters. When Asbel started doing well in 1500 meters,
yes,
you can see now we have had a very good dip of talent, including George Manangoi's brother.
Yeah, the two brothers.
Yeah, he finished seventh.
Yes.
The brother finished first.
Yes.
So we can see we have good hope in that. And when you look at even the women's racing, the minute Vivian Cheruiyot started beating the Ethiopians,
yes,
we now saw people like Faith Chengetich, we saw people now like Helen Obiri. So these guys, the beauty about our athletics is that there is that pooling of talent.
Yes.
If we see good Maradonas, somebody sets a record, Samuel Wanjiru, when you look at people who started opening the marathon from Tears for Kenyans, people like Martin Lell. Now we have the Eliud Kipchoges, you have so many good marathon runners around.
Yeah.
So it's one thing that shows that as long as these guys are winning, they'll always attract new talent to those disciplines. And that is why you can see we did very well in Doha. You could see even apart from Obiri, we had Ridian Kasait, we had Beatrice Chepkoech, we had so many other good people in middle distances, in middle to long track distances. So the outlook for Doha, if this translates to September, if Obiri can do an 8:25 right now, and it's very early in May.
Yes.
If Manangwe can do an 1:32 in May, it means that by the time it gets to the World Championships, you are expecting people like Manangwe to be in the region of 3:37.
Yes.
People like Obiri will be somewhere very near to close to the world record, or to the championship record. So the start is positive, and we can only hope for better.
Nigel Amos is killing us in 800 meters. It is his time now that Rudisha is not racing.
Well, Nigel Amos is the second fastest runner in history, of course, behind Rudisha in that final of 2012 London. And if we look at it this way, Emmanuel Korid is a very good athlete.
Yeah.
But he's still evolving. He needs to know how to win races. Because what Amos has perfected over the years is how to win races.
Yes.
Of course, when Rudisha was around, he was always trying to look for the second, until when he beat him in the Commonwealth in 2014.
Yes.
But what we need to do is that our 800 meters runners need, we have very good talent.
Yeah.
Not even Corinne himself. We even have people like Saruni.
Yes.
Ferguson is still around.
Yes.
Bet is still there. So what they need to do is to learn how to plan their races tactically. Because 800 is one of the most technical races in athletics.
Yes.
Because it is very short, yet very long. There is no time to plan tactics.
Yes.
If you get it wrong once, it's a done deal. Because you don't have time to recover. Maybe in 1500 you can run from the back and catch people on the home stretch and so on and so forth. So what we need to do is that our runners need to sit down and analyze races. There's one thing Rudisha always kept telling me. Look and know your distance, know your race.
Yes.
Know what is 800 meters. How many splits do you have? You have 200 meters, 400 meters, 600 meters, then 800 meters. Train and plan how to run across all of them. And know that this is a field that is open.
Yes.
Apart from Amos, we have people from Ethiopia, you have guys from Morocco, you have guys from...
Who have mastered the 800
so
meters.
So 800 is like a school. It's like a technical, it's like that you need to sit like in rap conditions and analyze how am I going to run this, and that is maybe that Korea needs to work on, because we know he has the talent, he has the speed, he just needs to work on the tactics and know when you want to bite Nigel, what do you do? Do you get out very fast or do you close in very fast? So depending on how you analyze and analyzing the split times, and I think, but I know that we can push him right now. He looks like he's on top, but he's one guy I know that we can beat.
Big conversation there when it comes to athletics with Mutwiru Mutwota, a very good athletics journalist here in Kenya. But also, the greatest marathoner in the world, Eliud Kipchoge, you have covered him, you have seen him race by race and up to where he is at the moment. Will there be anyone come closer to where Eliud Kipchoge is?
Right now, in the current generation, I don't think so.
Yeah.
The only thing is that Eliud has done for the marathon sport. First of all, he picked up from where Wanjiru left.
Yes, Samuel.
Yeah, Samuel, the late Samuel. He was the first athlete to change the course of marathon running. Because before Wanjiru happened, especially that race in Beijing 2008, I would advise people, if you have never watched it, just go to YouTube and look for it.
Yes.
The rules of the marathon were, start conservatively, then finish strongly.
Yes.
Because they thought the distance is too big for you to attack from the off.
Yes.
But in Wanjiru, in 2008, Wanjiru changed the rules of marathon running.
Yes.
He proved that with the training, you can actually run quickly.
Yes.
For 42 kilometers, 0.195.
Yes.
For example, in London, with the two Ethiopians,
yeah,
in the 40th kilometer, Eliud did the 40th kilometer in 4 minutes and 26 seconds.
Yes.
For somebody who has run for 39 kilometers to then again cover the 40th kilometer in 4 minutes and 26 seconds, that was absolutely insane.
Yes.
That was madness.
Yeah.
So the thing is, Wanjiru and now Eliud has shown that there is no limit to the human abilities. And even when he ran in Monza, 2 hours 0025 in that Formula 1 track.
Yes.
He said...
Breaking two.
Yeah, breaking two. He said there is no limit to the what a human can do. He's announced he's going back to Berlin to try and run a faster time than what he ran.
Yes.
And few doubt against it. It's because, like he told me some time back, he's become a good student of the marathon. Sit down, analyze what he did. What he did last time, where he went wrong, and work on it on training. Because there's nothing that is actually won on race day. Everything is won on training. Those 3 months that you train for a marathon, that is where everything is done.
Yeah.
For example, if it's the workouts, if I ran, like for example, he ran 2:02:37 in London, 38 in London.
Yes.
If he was to go back and break the course record in 2020, he will go through all his splits and go back to training and see, here do I push myself a bit? Do I reduce?
Yes.
Do I increase? So I think what Eliud has done to the marathon world is to leave a template for anyone else who wants to follow, has to work in. Some time back, Haile and Tergat, who were considered the great marathoners of their time, they were asked whether running beyond 2 hours was possible. And I remember Haile said it is impossible. In fact, that would be insanity.
Yes.
But the way Eliud is doing it, it's very possible. Maybe he might not be the one to achieve it.
But someone can.
But he has left a template for people to sit down and study.
Yes.
Because everything in sport, there is a lot of science. It's not just waking up and deciding I want to run.
Yes.
You must train yourself. You must know your body. You must fit your body to the conditions. Yes. You must know the conditions of where you're running in. The weather conditions also must be right. Because you can see, like what happened to him in Berlin, was it in 2016, I think. when the insole of the shoe came out,
yes,
he was on course to run a record, but such things. So every variable must be right.
Yeah.
And you do the right timing. And you know that you're not just running against the clock. There are also other runners who are very good and big champions also. Mm-hmm. So you have to beat a very good field. You have to be at the best of your conditions.
Yes.
And the conditions themselves, from your shoe to everything, must be right.
Yeah.
But I believe that wherever LOD is right now, he's untouchable.
Yeah.
But I think the biggest thing he has contributed to the sport is he has now given us a manual to run the marathon.
Yeah. Big one there for Eliud. Lastly, our team is going to the Yokohama Japan World Relays. Which gold medals will you be expecting? Will we improve from our performance or from the Bahamas?
I think when it comes to the relay team, we have not yet found a good team that is capable of winning. Let's say the best performance was about the first edition when we won 3 gold medals, I think.
Yes.
The second edition, we did not fare very well. I think we have not yet grasped the concept of this relay. Or there's some apathy because it is happening too very early in the outdoor season.
Yes.
And most of our athletes are conditioned to look for medals in the world championship because yes. That is where they know if you're a world champion for the next 2 years, you'll get good appearance fees and all that.
Yeah.
So I think that you have not entirely embraced the concept of the relays.
Yes.
But the team, but you cannot put anything away from the Kenyan team.
Yeah.
So I think maybe we can expect at most 1 or 2 gold medals.
Ah, I cannot let you go without talking about your favorite English Premier League team. How are you faring? How do you feel your team is so far with the new coach and everything?
Arsenal this season has a mixed bag.
Yeah.
Has been a mixed bag. But to be honest, even the most optimistic Arsenal fan did not expect they would be in this position at this particular point in the season. Which position are we talking about? We are talking about with 1 foot in the finals of the Europa League.
Yes.
Last season at a time like this, it was all over when Atletico came and beat them 1-0 at the Emirates. And also in a position to challenge for the top four. Of course, losing 9 points over the last 3 games was not ideal.
Yes.
From a good position. But with 2 games to go, they are still in it with Chelsea, Manchester United and Tottenham as well.
Yes.
So if you would have asked any optimistic Arsenal fan, we would be here at this particular point of the season. The answer would have been a no. Because for the last 4 seasons under Arsene Wenger, the club was in decline. There were very few players of quality.
Yes.
You can compare with the Arsenal team that was beating everyone. So at this point, Unai has done very well. We are just hoping that when it comes to the close season, Mr. Kroenke will open his purse strings and will fortify the sides because we cannot understand why people like Mustafi call themselves professional footballers.
Yes.
People like, we also have Mavropoulos and so many other defenders.
Yes.
Yes, they are good players, we are not refusing, but they are not the class of the kind of a team that Arsenal could be expecting.
Yeah.
The same thing that is happening at Man United at the moment.
Yes.
You find that the club has got players who are good, but not the class of the team that was there before. As we see Manchester City and Liverpool and Tottenham to some extent are running away with it.
Yeah.
So we can say that it's not been good, it's not been bad for Arsenal.
Yes.
Whatever we can get now, we can take it. If it's top four, fine. If it's the Europa League trophy, okay.
But you love the consistency in that now the team is growing step by step.
Yeah, consistency has been a problem because they had gone, there's a time they went to 22 games unbeaten, then they started losing games. Right now they had a very good home record, I think winning the last 10, but the last 3 have not come out to be like that.
Yeah.
Crystal Palace came and shocked them. So they have still not yet become a consistent side like what we can see from Liverpool, Man City and Tottenham.
Yeah.
Like even when you have a blip, it's not for so long. Because losing 3 games in a row, 9 points, if you add 9 points to their tally today, they will be up in that.
Yes.
So those are what you're talking about. So there is this likelihood they can take their chance and there's this likelihood also they can miss it all.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying it's been a mixed season, a bag of mixed season.
Who do you predict to win the Champions League?
At this moment, you don't see anyone outside Barcelona.
Yes.
Because for one thing, they have been there before.
Mm-hmm.
Of the 3 remaining clubs, Liverpool lost the final last year.
Yes.
The last time the Liverpool won was in 2005. And most of those players have moved on. They have since moved on from the team. So sometimes it's all about the experience, being there and knowing.
Yes.
Barcelona, they were there, I think, 3 years ago.
Yes.
With most of the current squad, they were there with the Messi's of this, all Busquets, people like we have people like what is this, Suarez and others.
Yeah.
All those guys were there, mm-hmm. so they know when it comes what to do at the business end of the season.
Yeah.
Ajax, it's been what 20 what years since the last
95.
Since 1995.
Yeah.
It's like the last time they got 96.
Yes.
That's when they have been reaching in a position to reach the final.
Yes.
Tottenham have never gone this far.
Yes.
So we can say that among them, Barcelona have the know-how how to win this trophy, and sometimes that's what makes a difference.
Yes.
Because talent-wise, you can't get to the semi-final if your team is not talented.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have beaten very good teams along the way. We have Man City around, Juventus, you know, Bayern Munich.
They have actually not lost any match in the Champions League.
So you can see that, and at the start of the season, Messi told, and you know he rarely speaks, but he told the crowd at Camp Nou, this season you're going to get this.
Yes.
So there is that also single-minded focus amongst a group of players that leads them to the trophy.
Yeah.
But then again, this is football. Crazy things have happened. But if you ask me, the money is on Barcelona.
Yeah. Well, thanks a lot, Mutwiri Mutota. I really appreciate having you here to talk to us on all matters athletics. That is Mutwiri Mutota, the digital content editor at SportPesa. That's it for us here on this interview. When we come back, for now we'll be looking at a nostalgic feel of Eliud Kipchoge and all the marathons he has run in, because he has run in 13 marathons and he has won 12 of them, only losing one marathon. How good is Eliud Kipchoge? Plus some other highlights from the UEFA Champions League and the Europa League. When we come back, we'll be talking all matters fan zone.